Marwah Rizqy.
Marwah Rizqy, Liberal MNA for the Montreal riding of St-Laurent. Good evening. Good evening. You were noticed as soon as you went into politics. After 2018, you were the revelation of the parliamentary session. When we read about you, we always hear the same criteria. You are a fighter, you're determined, you are stubborn. What do you attribute your personality to? It's very strong. I've always been intense, and I've always wanted to defend against injustice, defend people. I've always wanted to fight and to defend myself. Often said quite openly that things weren't easy at home. There was a climate of violence for my father. And I often defied his authority because I found what he was doing was awful, not just what doing to me, but doing to my mother. And I think that side of me, the fighter, I think comes from childhood. Your mother is from Morocco, your father as well. They met here in Quebec. Your mother left everything behind, a life of poverty, to come to Quebec. Your mother had a great deal of influence on you, obviously. Tell us a little about your childhood. What kind of family did you grow up in? What values did you get from your mother? I had two very different models at home, a very violent father. That was the dark side. On the other side, there was the light, my mother, a woman who was resistant and resilient. And those are the same thing. My mother was Mother Teresa. She did everything for us. If you just look at her hands, they're hands that have lived. She did so much cleaning. When I was younger, she said, you know, if you don't want to become a house cleaner, get through school and get your high school diploma. Because even if you want to drive a bus, you'll need a high school diploma. She always wanted to go to school because she couldn't, and she wanted us to be educated. It was so important to her. The day she had an opportunity to go to school, she learned to read and write here in Quebec, and it was so important to her. Sometimes she corrects herself. She always makes the same mistakes, condo and condom. She always gets them mixed up. She's always just rolled up her sleeves and worked because she wanted us to have the best. That didn't mean private school, that meant public school. But the very little money she had, she'd buy us a tantan book, for example, so that wouldn't be different from the other kids. We'd get little gifts at Christmas or Boxing Day, because she explained that on Boxing Day, presents would be 50% cheaper. Very thrifty woman. As sometimes when she'd see a show on using coupons, she said she'd invented the art. She doesn't throw anything away, saves everything. She's extraordinary, and I wish everybody could have a mother like that. Education meant everything to your mother, and you are very highly educated. You're a lawyer. You're a member of the Quebec Bar, of the New York Bar. You got a PhD in the United States at the University of Florida. So tell us something about your studies. I was really bored. I was in law at Sherbrooke University. What I really enjoyed was my course on tax law. When I told the professor I wanted to do tax law and apply to Toronto University, he said, no, that's not very ambitious. Go to the U.S. I was in his living room at home filling out my application forms about 2 weeks before the deadline. And he said, you know, they're taking the top five. So I was writing to NYU, University of Florida, Washington University. I was also applying for a scholarship because it just cost a fortune. The prof said, don't worry, you'll get in. A few months later, I received an email, and I thought, oh God, I got an email, so it's a rejection. I had made a huge mistake in my application to the University of Florida. I had written the best university is NYU because I'd used a template. And the person who emailed said, would you like to correct this in your application letter? Well, it's great that they give you the opportunity. You know, I'd taken a template. The first one I'd written was to NYU, and I'd forgotten to change New York University to the University of Florida in the first question. I got in during the early bird with the early bird pack, and that means they forgave my absolutely monumental error. I didn't wait for the other universities to respond. I accepted the University of Florida. I got a scholarship from Ketter Link Joward. I had two scholarships. I could do my tax law PhD and the other courses I needed. So you're a tax law expert. I believe in social justice, but in my view, social justice requires tax justice. The tax base is supported by us. You know, there was a time when companies paid taxes. I'm not talking about fair share. I'm talking about paying taxes, period. If people still think that Apple pays taxes, they don't. And the same goes for Alphabet, which is Google, really. They pay no taxes. They pay people like me, international tax law experts, to find loopholes and ways of getting around things, sometimes legally and sometimes not so legally. There's an agreement with Ireland, a secret agreement that made it possible for Google, Apple, Facebook, and Amazon and Microsoft not to pay tax in Ireland.
C'est en 2015 que vous décidez de faire le...
In 2015, you decided to jump into politics. You stood as a Liberal candidate in the federal riding of Hochelaga, came second. In 2017, you stood for a federal riding again in St-Laurent, came second again. And finally, in 2018, you were elected as a member of the National Assembly, the provincial legislature in Saint-Laurent for the Quebec Liberal Party as an MNA. So what has drawn you to liberal values? Even when I was a student at Sherbrooke University, I was in the Quebec Liberal Party's youth wing. When I left for the US, I wasn't a member of any party. When I came back, I found my liberal political family, went back to the Quebec Liberal Party, and then also became a member of the Federal Liberal Party.
Parce que j'avais vu Justin Trudeau.
I'd seen Justin Trudeau, who wanted to tackle poverty, lift children out of poverty.
Et aussi, c'est que je suis pas très conservatrice et je voulais sortir du gouvernement.
It was important to me. I wasn't a conservative. I wanted to get the Harper government out. So I wrote in for my online kit and I became a Liberal candidate in 2015. You say you want to have the web giants of the world paying taxes. The Trudeau government has introduced Bill 18. It's the legislation that will modernize the Broadcasting Act. The idea is to have web giants pay tax. What do you think of the Trudeau government's approach? I was disappointed because the Netflix tax is something I wrote when I didn't get elected in 2015. I was doing radio interviews, writing to the newspapers to explain what the Netflix tax was and the GAFA tax. Simply put, the Netflix tax is a sales tax. I want Apple and Netflix, when they do business in Canada, to pay sales tax, to collect sales tax, just like Videotron has to. The GAFAM tax is that the web giants should be paying taxes on their earnings. I found what the federal government was saying at the time to be quite damaging because they didn't think it was doable. Are you open to the idea of imposing a Netflix tax on high-speed internet, 5% sales tax on high-speed internet? Even your caucus members want it.
Reconnaissons l'importance dans notre système parlementaire.
We recognize how important it is in our parliamentary system to allow committees to do their work independently, to make recommendations. But I want to be very clear. We were elected a little over 18 months ago on a promise to lower taxes for the middle class. And that is what we will do and have done. I was happy to meet Mr. Couillard, because they felt that there was no question there should be a Netflix tax. I didn't want to be seen as, I couldn't be seen as a defender of fair taxation if what I supported wasn't going to go through. when Ottawa said it was going forward, and that it was constitutional. To this day, Quebec is getting money from a Netflix tax, and I'm very happy that finally it's being discussed. But what are they waiting for to get the bill passed? It's taking a long time. Yes, and there's something people don't realize. When I'm hearing people say, you know, the media are dying slowly, they're not dying slowly, they're dying very quickly. They're going down in flames. And with them, what's going down is our democracy. What's the point of having free speech if you can't get the information you need to form an opinion? Do you really have free speech then? I don't think so. I think freedom of speech includes freedom of information, but that freedom of information has a cost when investigative journalism is less and less findable, when we are seeing people losing their jobs, journalists losing their jobs. That is an attack on our democracy because journalism is the fourth pillar of our democracy. Let's come back to the provincial scene. Since you were elected in 2018, you've been an education critic for the opposition. There are columnists who've called you the Quebec education minister's nightmare. My question was very clear. It lasted 10 seconds, and what I'm hearing is the same preamble. There are 30,000 teachers which are not legally qualified. Do you have a target? If you don't, just say you don't. How would you describe Quebec's education system? Well, it's very lacking. The Minister of Education conducts umpteen assessments. It doesn't stop assessing children, but it isn't assessing itself. Every time I ask the department a question, I get, we don't have the data. How many teachers will be retiring? Don't have the data. How many people reported work-related accidents? Don't have the data. How many contacts and firearms and violent incidents are there in your schools? Don't have the data. It's not enough to have posters saying zero tolerance for violence. The violence exists. Violence has doubled, tripled across Quebec. If somebody's been arrested three times for living off immoral earnings and they're still teaching, what is that? In 2019, you proposed to your own party, to the Quebec Liberal Party, that it apologize for the years of Philippe Couillard's austerity. I remember that in my youth there was so much happening and being built and being done, the metro, the Olympics, the James Bay project. But we have lost a great many levers and means to act because of our financial situation. Why did you want him to apologize? When I was elected, I met with lots of groups and lots of people. What I observed wherever I went is that people would be talking about the years they found very difficult. Budgetary constraint and austerity, it doesn't matter what you call it, it's what people felt that matters, what they experienced. I felt that if we wanted to once again build back bridges with Quebecers and get out of opposition, we had to understand what they were saying, and we had to show them that we understood what they were saying. Budget cuts were just too quick and too steep, and it hurt. So I felt the party should send a message showing that it understood so that we could reconnect with Quebecers. Well, before you reconnect, you have to hear them. You have to listen. Listening and hearing, they're not the same thing, and sometimes people don't get that. So first, we had to admit we'd gone too fast with budget cuts. And Carlos Letaoud admitted that. He was Minister of Finance at the time. It takes humility to say, look, if we were going to do it again, we wouldn't go as fast. Our interim leader recognized the same thing. Perhaps I recognized it too soon. Sometimes it takes people longer, but we've got to the same point today. So there's not much disagreement. At the time, there was huge disagreement. A columnist said on the radio to Paul Arcand that there was chaos in caucus because of what I'd said. But everyone had already heard me on the radio and on television, read me in the newspapers. I speak clearly. I don't repeat the same message bureaucratically. I may leave politics one day if I'm ever obliged to talk like that. But now, people know what I'm like, I know what they like, and it works well. People know that if they put a question to me, they will get an answer. It may be, it will be honest, but they may not like it. You say what you think. I know that this is a government of accountants. There are a number of accountants, and I know that your performance-led. Is it great to be at 1.1% of your goal? That's absolutely tragic. We want politicians who say what they think, but there's so much risk to doing that. You can trip so easily. In 2030, we just want to make sure that the answer we get isn't we'll see. Today, there are far fewer, or how many, children in daycare than there were in 2018. In 2021, you became part of history. You married Greg Kelly, another MNA. It was the first time in 229 years of Quebec parliamentary life that two members of the National Assembly got married. And you have made history again, because at the time that you were touring the National Assembly, you just had a baby. Gabriel, you and your husband took your oath by video conference because you were at home with your child. So there's a number of firsts. How is work-life balance working out for you? Well, Greg and I are both parents for the first time. Usually one or other would have parental leave. We don't. So yes, it makes things more difficult. I have colleagues at the University of Sherbrooke who are wondering how I'm managing. It's something we have to look at. Elected officials should have, I think, parental leave, but I can't be part of that discussion. But Véronique Yvon did move a motion about parental leave for elected officials. There are many young parents at the National Assembly, parents with young children. Do you think politics and political life is adapted to how people live today? No, not at all. In the things I had to think about to stand in 2022, well, what mattered was there would be daycare at the National Assembly month after month after month. We didn't see this daycare, and it won't be there until September. Greg and I have no choice. We always have the baby with us. It would help us a great deal to have daycare when we are both in committee. We take him to committee with us all the time. In 2018, this was a priority. We asked for daycare. We've asked for it many times, and I don't think that message has really been heard. I know there's been a pandemic, and now it's 2022, and the National Assembly is about to rise. So the winning conditions weren't there when the last term finished. And when we came back in 2022, still no daycare. Ms. Rizqy, you're very well known for a transpartisan approach. You say that work is far more effective when it's transpartisan, when all parties work together, and you say women do that better. Well, we did this very naturally with Francine Charbonneau, Jennifer McCarron, and Christine Larbrie, basically a wall of women facing Jean-François Roberge. He wasn't used to that. But when he replied to one of our colleagues rather dryly, four colleagues would say, no, this is not how you speak. This is mansplaining. Don't be condescending. Don't assume we haven't read the report and we have to go and read it. And the reason we're asking these very specific questions is because we actually have read the report. It was quite a unique experience. I've worked on other issues with different parties. People are surprised. Some Alexandre Maurice once asked me what I was thinking about tax havens, the NDP, the Bloc, you know, tax havens. If everybody could be in a tax haven, that would be great. But it's results that count for me. And what I want is everybody to get a fair shake. Tax havens have been around for 100 years, so it's going to be quite some work to get rid of them. You are of Arab origin. There is a debate going on Islamophobia. There was a shooting at the Islamic Cultural Center in Quebec City. Do you think Quebec is an Islamophobic society? It's very difficult for me to answer that question because I don't think my example is the right one. Since I was very little, I haven't been subject to racist activities. I grew up in Montreal. I've been in Sherbrooke and Saguenay. I've always been welcomed very well. That's how I've lived. But other people have had horrible experiences. They've been spat at because they were wearing a hijab. I've seen dreadful comments given to women because they're wearing a hijab, paid speech. I'm convinced Quebec isn't more racist than any other spot in the world. I've lived in Florida. It was pretty big deal. We have shown that when somebody's called Mohammed, for example, it's never mind the job. It's harder to get an interview. To be called in for an interview if your name's Mohammed is more difficult. So what do? Hide our names? Change our CVs? I'm totally against that because once the person appears before you, is still going to be Marwah, is still going to be Mohammed, is still going to have darker skin than you. So when the shooting happened in Quebec City, the whole province rose up and said, no, no xenophobia, no racism. Unfortunately, there will always be racism. We want people who want to work hard in Quebec, people who have proposals to put forward. And if your democratic legacy is to say you've channeled hate, then don't do that. Think hard before you want to get into parliament with that. Are you thinking about Éric Duhem when you're saying that? Clearly, yes. If you apply to a lot of places and you never get a call back when you're absolutely qualified, don't forget that for every rejected parent, there is a frustrated child. There's been a controversy about Amira El Gawabi as the representative for anti-Islamophobia. The National Assembly even moved a motion calling for her to be removed from her position. What did you think of her appointment? We voted against her appointment in the Liberal Party with other members of the National Assembly. Some people abstained. I have a simple rule. If you become more important than the cause you represent and more visible than the cause you represent, you're in the wrong spot. You're in the wrong position. You are a woman in your 30s from a cultural community. We know that it's very difficult to attract young people into politics. Why do you think that is? Well, first of all, you have to make some room. I had luck at the Quebec Liberal Party. They had a great riding for me. St-Laurent is an amazing riding. I take no one for granted. So my door knocking goes very well because it's a Liberal riding when you're 33 and you're offered a riding for like that. And my husband was in Jacques Cartier. Lots of young people. Madoua in northern Montreal. So you need to make room for people. Some people end up with ridings where they don't have much chance to win. So I'm contradicting myself, I know. So sometimes things are complex. I learned a lesson with federal politics. I chose Hochelaga, and everybody said I'd be crazy. This wasn't a winnable riding, many said. But I tried. I tried for a year and a half. I lost, but I lost by 500 votes. That riding for 30 years had voted the Liberal Party into third place, and now it's a Liberal riding. So if I have a message for young people, is this. Even if you think it's not winnable, go ahead. Go knocking on doors. Because even if you don't win, you might have made a difference. I have a cause in politics, and I would invite people who want to get into politics to think about what they want to change in the world, what they want to change in society, because if they don't, they'll find it boring. I was there for a cause. I found it hard at first. If you don't have conviction, it'll be harder. If you have conviction, if you know what you're fighting for or who you're fighting for, then you'll be able to hang on. Quebec has only ever elected one woman premier in its history, Pauline Marois, who had an 18-month minority government. Even with a minority government, I plan to get results for people. Do you think Quebec is ready for a woman premier? Yes, we've had one, Pauline Marois. Now, are women ready to go for it? Not that many women aspire to be leader of a political party. We see that. Ms. Anglade was the only woman for the Liberal Party of Quebec who was a party leader. There are many men who raise their hands and throw their hats in the ring, but fewer women. There will be a leadership race eventually. You have a great deal of experience, and many believe that you would be an ideal candidate. Would you be interested? I have a 4-month-old baby. It is out of question for me to enter a leadership race at this point. What about in the long term? One day? Well, why not? I've never shut the door to looking to be leader of a party or becoming premier. But now I'm not throwing my hat in the ring. I've made it very clear that it's not going to happen. I have my third baby. I have my first child. I would like another. If I can succeed right now, I have diapers to think about and baby bottles to think about, and my mental load just can't take on anymore. I've got a balance almost at the moment. I'm still trying to reach a balance. So in 10 years, who knows? Your mother has been very important to you. She sacrificed a great deal to make sure that her daughters, her children would study and get ahead in life. What does your mother think of what you've achieved? Well, for the degrees, she always says they're her degrees. She said, I did everything for her to get those degrees, and they're her diplomas. As for politics, she thinks it's nuts. She's not political. The first time she voted was when I was running in Hochelaga. Then when I stood again for a federal riding, she thought that was nuts. When I got elected in St-Laurent for the National Assembly, she cries. She also tries to see how I manage my day. She likes to follow my interviews. I have several in a day open. And she said, you know, just watching you, I'm out of breath. I'm out of breath for you. Marwah Rizqy, thank you very much. Thank you.